Honorable speakers of the day, all our distinguished invited guests, management and delegate from our sponsors, our past chairman, chairman of the Dubai chapter, CA Naveen Sharma, vice chairman, CA Mahmood Bangara, my colleagues in the managing committee, dear members of the chapter, ladies and gentlemen, namaste. Good morning. On behalf of ICAI Dubai, I welcome all of you. Ladies and gentlemen, today's session is very important as topics to be covered in today's session has affected all of us directly or indirectly, that is financial crimes, corporate governance, and other related topics. Financial crimes or economic crimes such as asset misappropriation, business misconduct, money laundering, fraud committed by consumers, etc., are surging day by day, and they can have a long-lasting effect on a company's brand and seriously damage its reputation. The burden on regulated institutions is growing, so that there is an urgent need to improve the effectiveness of prevention and detection systems, internal audit, anti-fraud technologies, fraud risk management, use of real-time monitoring, assist the organization in combating financial frauds or economic crimes. Having said about the crimes and means to prevent them, it is very true that preventing and discovering frauds in an organization is not an easy task. It involves a focus of culture and people in addition to investing in controls and technology. In other words, increasing need of corporate governance is required to keep financial crimes under control. Also, there is an increasing need of fraud and economic risk assessment, or there is an increasing demand of forensic audits and the auditors. Ladies and gentlemen, we look forward to hear all our eminent speakers of the day. Mr. Hassan Nasir, Director Compliance Risk and Training, Crowe, UAE. CA Amarjeet Chopra, our past president of ICAI. CA Badri Vishal Mahajan, Director Business and Risk Advisory, Mayur Batra Group. And last but not the least, CA Chetan Dalal, founder and CEO, Chetan Dalal Investigation and Management Services. On behalf of everyone present here, I welcome all our speakers of the day. Please join me in welcoming all of them. So I wish you all a great day ahead, and thank you very much for joining us. I request our chairman, CA Naveen Sharma, to please come at the podium to deliver the chairman's address.
Ladies and gentlemen, members and guests, good morning. The world has changed in the last 100 years. Violence has declined. Is it echoing? However, more people are dying because of financial distress and crimes than traditional wars. Importance of corporate governance has increased manifold, and forensic audit has become mainstream. Risk cannot be eliminated, but it can only be managed. Managing the risk in a smart way is the need of the hour. Your chapter is organizing today's full-day technical seminar on the topic of financial crimes, corporate governance, forensic audit, and smart risk management. We are fortunate to have a galaxy of speakers who will be addressing all of us. Central Council member CA Babu is expected shortly, and he is coming to attend our session and update about the campus recruitment, which your chapter has suggested to the ICAI, and now it has become a global movement. We have seen majority of the institutions nowadays going for the campus recruitment, but overseas campus recruitment not happening. When I came 20 years back, and today, young chartered accountant has to go to the same process. And there is no structural way where a seasoned chartered accountant or experienced chartered accountant can find the job. The world has changed, technology has given us many, many options. So wait for his presentation, and this has become a global movement. We started from here. Today also, hundreds of CAs are coming in Dubai every year, and they go through the same hardship which you and me have gone through. And I think by the initiatives of the ICAI, things will change for better. On behalf of all of you, I welcome Mr. Hassan Nasser, Director Compliance and Risk and Training, Crow UAE, CA Amarjit Chopra Saab, past president of ICAI. We are lucky that we will listen to him today. CA Badri Vishal Mahajan, Director Business Risk and Advisory, Mayur Batra Group, and CA Chetan Dalal, founder and CEO, Chetan Dalal Investigation and Management Services. Ladies and gentlemen, members and guests, give a big round of applause to all our speakers. Thank you, sirs, for accepting our invitation to address all of us. Now, I would like to update you about our chapter. History is created on 23rd June when 10 members have paid workshop fees through credit card. Last Wednesday, the online credit card facility is now available to the members to renew their fees. The long-standing demand which we promised at the beginning of the year that we will make the credit card payment so that transaction become easy is now operational. Close to 200 members have already paid their fees through credit card. As you are aware that your chapter is now registered as non-profit incorporated organization NPIO under DIFC. Your chapter is a registered chapter as NPIO under DIFC, and because of that credit card facility, online payment, everything become possible. With the incorporation of your chapter under DIFC as NPIO, the credentials of your chapter will further improve. Give a big round of applause to our chapter. This is for your chapter. You can clap one more time. Nowadays, chartered accountants have many options. They can take up employment or they can start their own practice. New areas are opening up like venture capital, M&A, fintech, and many, many more. However, two things are central like blood in the body, and we need to have skills of these two essential skills every chartered accountant have. Can you tell me the two skills which, irrespective of we are into the practice or we are into the service or we are in A industry or B industry, which a chartered accountant must have? What number one skills which we need to know? Can someone tell me? Microsoft Excel. Microsoft Excel is like a blood in the body. We need to understand. I used to work a lot on Excel, and I can say 10-12 years back, but today the Excel is completely different. It has so many features that has improved our life. First is Microsoft Excel. Whatever we do, we cannot avoid Excel. Even if we are working on one of the best softwares like SAP, Oracle, Microsoft, but still you need to know Microsoft Excel. And what about the second in the UAE? Essential skill. Whether you are in practice, whether you are not in practice, whether you are in employment. Okay. I think it is, some may disagree, is VAT. We need to have some basic knowledge of value-added tax. Your chapter thought to combine these two, and I'm delighted to share that after enormous hard work, we are coming out with a unique technical seminar for 4 hours next Saturday on 21st of July. CA Anurag Chaturvedi will speak on recent updates on VAT, and CA Naveen Ajmera, only the first name is same, I'm not so good in Excel, so Mr. Naveen Ajmera will speak on Microsoft Excel specifically for chartered accountants. It's not about Microsoft Excel, which you are not going to use. So he has designed what you need as a chartered accountant. He will cover comprehensive collection of features, functions, and techniques that we have that have direct benefit to chartered accountants. In fact, in 2011, when I was in America to drop my son, there is a bookstore, pen bookstore, which is 5th floor, and I searched one book, which is Microsoft Excel for auditors. And believe me, there are so many good functions which we do on a regular basis. If We divide Excel, there are scientific formulas, there are financial calculations, and that we have developed our program. I'm sure that you will all like that. But the best part is the session of automizing VAT returns through the power of Excel. Our speaker will show live how to automate VAT returns through the power of Excel by giving practical issues, case studies, scenario analysis, live demonstration of audit tools, sanitizing data, jet testing, exceptional reporting, and the famous 0 hours which we started in the month of October. Probably we will be doing the last time in the present XCOM, and we will have the 0 hours. Do not miss this session. We have to do the VAT returns, and if we can automize, this is a one-time job, and you can, if you have any issues, you can write to us. Circular will be issued hopefully today, and then we will try to incorporate that. I would not like to take much of your time as we have back-to-back speakers. Now I request our Vice Chairman, CA Mahmood Bangara, to introduce the first speaker, Mr. Hassan Nasser, to all of us.
Good morning. Good morning, everyone. Now, this is the time for me to introduce Mr. Hassan Nasser. As you all know that any country, any population, any nation, any economy is dependent upon the prudent and healthy financial practices. A couple of instances I do remember people saying that shocks and shivers that we may suffer due to any malpractices, non-compliances may shake the economy. So it's quite important. And as we, a vital professional body here, we would like to bring this session out. And here we have an expert who would be talking about risk and compliances, a very experienced person, Mr. Hassan Nasser. Hassan Nasser has over 30 years of experience in compliance, risk management, fraud prevention, anti-money laundering, and combating the financing of terrorism, corporate governance, responsible sourcing, anti-bribery, and anti-corruption and commodities. Nasser is certified in Advanced Enterprise Risk Management, ERM, a certified compliance officer, and a certified anti-money laundering specialist, CAMS. He holds an MBA in financial management. Hassan is a renowned international advisor, speaker, and trainer in the following topics also: commodities market, physical and financial, responsible sourcing and risk management for supply chains, capital requirements, directives including Basel 2 and 3, risk management with special emphasis on credit, operational risk, corporate governance, etc. Mr. Nasser is currently Director of Compliance, Risk and Training at Crow UAE. Previously, he joined Dubai Multi-Commodity Center, DMCCA, in 2006 as Director of Compliance and was leading the risk management function. He was instrumental in establishing the compliance and risk management frameworks with all of its divisions. Hassan was involved in training DMCCA staff and government agencies associating with major banks and renowned international training firms. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me to welcome Mr. Hassan Nasser to address us.
And I have this problem of a weak voice. I'll try as much as possible, especially people are back. I hope they are hearing me very, very clearly. Raise your hand if you are. Okay. Thank you first for inviting me to speak about this very esteemed audience here. Yes. First, thank you very much for inviting me to speak in front of this esteemed audience. Today, as you see from the title here, we are going to speak about financial crimes, different type of financial crimes. First, what is financial crime? Somebody can tell us what is a financial crime, what we call it a financial crime. Any crime associated to money, we call it a financial crime, because we have two types of crimes. Crimes that have nothing to do with money. And for instance, sorry to give this bad example, a wife killing her husband. for infidelity. That's not financial crime. It's a crime, but it's not financial. And I'm a drug dealer.
Financial crime, as I said, is a crime associated with money, okay? Whenever any, for instance, drug dealing. Why people are doing drug dealing? Again, there is an echo again. It's clear, and I see the echo here, but it's not affecting, okay? For instance, a drug dealer, what he's doing to distributing drugs, because he likes, maybe he likes, but this is not the main objective for him to distribute drugs. The main objective is to generate money, profit. All criminal organizations, they do this for money. For that, we call it financial crime. Can somebody tell us the most, what we call it, the mother of the financial crime, what it is? Just, what is the mother of the financial, what is the most important financial crime? Money laundering. Why money laundering? It's good, but yes, money laundering is the mother, because everything ends with money, need to be laundered. If I'm criminal, I need to launder that money. Why I need to launder my money? What the reason? Sorry? I don't hear it very well, but two reasons that I launder my money. First, I'm committing a crime. I need to continue committing this crime all together. Secondly, I want to enjoy my money, my illicit money. And suppose, for instance, to give you a general example, a drug dealer distributes drugs worth $1 million every day. He takes this, he doesn't think about having any kind of money laundering. He takes this money, go to the bank, and try to deposit the money into the bank system. What will happen to him? First, somebody will suspect it's too much money and in cash. For somebody will make a reporting against him. Police will follow him. Very quickly, they'll find out that he's distributing drugs. He will be arrested, first thing. Secondly, the money that he deposited already to the bank will be seized. But two things happen. First, he stopped his criminal activity. Secondly, the money has been taken from him. That's the reason why people are doing money laundering. To continue conducting the criminal activity, first, and secondly, to enjoy this dirty money. That's they need to do money laundering, okay? Is it clear now why people do money laundering? Let's see more in details how they do it. First, what is money laundering? What I said is just purpose for money laundering. But let's see the definition. There is a legal definition, but it's a little bit complicated. And I put it in a way I can call it functional definition instead of illegal definition. First, we have actions. We do things. What we do, let's see, conversion, concealing, disguising, transferring, exchanging, transporting, depositing, keeping, managing, disposing, saving or whatever, okay? These are actions conducted by somebody, just doing actions. For purpose, I'm not speaking about language here. If I'm a money launderer, what would be the difference for me between concealing and conversion? Concealing and disguising. What would be the difference? From the money laundering perspective. What would be the difference? Can somebody tell us? Concealing, it means that the money is not visible to others. Disguising is visible, but appear as being legal. Yeah, for instance, to give you a practical example, suppose I establish a company and I put my money behind this company and no one knows that I'm the owner of this company. In this case, I'm disguising the illegal money into a company, under a company banner. For no one will associate myself as Hassan Nasser with this money. But if I go to establish a business, supermarket, everyone knows that I'm the owner of the supermarket. But they think that the money coming to me is not dirty money, but it's money coming from the operation of the supermarket. In this case, I'm disguising, not concealing. You need the difference now, it's clear? Difference between concealing and disguising, okay? Who are the players here? Khalas, we know this action has been done. Somebody doing something, acts, we know this. Transferring, disguising, all this, okay? Moving, managing, all this we know. Who are the players? First, somebody knows that this money is dirty. It's coming from a criminal activity. Who will be knowing that this money is dirty? The criminal himself. He knows. Somebody should have known. This is a little bit, there is ambiguity. He should have known. Who should have known in this case that this is dirty money or coming from a criminal activity? Sorry? For instance, associate, friend, family, all these people would be, should have known, okay? Yeah, and for instance, to give you a practical example, the case of Madoff, there was a big, maybe if you have time, we'll speak about, when you speak about fraud. Madoff is a guy created something called a Ponzi scheme. Ponzi scheme is investment for nothing. There is no investment. I take your money for... But then I give you return for money coming, new coming money. All the investors taking the return for new investors. That's to call it a Ponzi scheme. It's created the name of a guy called Ponzi. He created this concept of giving people return, all the investors, from money coming for new investors. For this Ponzi scheme, Madoff have two sons. The whole idea, whether these two sons should have known that Madoff is doing this or not. And this was their case. Because you are associate, you are family. You should have known. So if you go to court, you said, no, I didn't know. Or I'm in position to know. So I should have known is somebody, very associate, the criminal person, by his position as association or closeness to this person, you should have known that this guy is committing crime and the money is therefore coming is criminal money. Okay. Somebody suspected. In the case of the $1 million that I'm depositing in the bank every day, the teller should suspect. The teller didn't suspect by negligence or by lack of knowledge. He could be prosecuted in this case. Why? Because in his position, should have suspected. He didn't suspect due to negligence or because he didn't know nothing about money laundering. That's the importance of training. Or he suspected. After suspecting, he did what? Nothing. Again, a prosecution. He should have done what? Reported. If you suspect, if you don't suspect because of negligence or because of a lack of knowledge, or if you suspected, but you didn't report it, you can part of the conspiracy of money laundering. Okay, you are contributing in the money laundering scheme. Okay. Somebody assisting, it means that I know. In this case, I go to the bank, I pay a bribe to a clerk, to the teller, I tell him, this is dirty money, help me to launder this money, I'll give you some bribe or some money. He's assisting, he's legally, willingly assisting the money laundering, okay? And for what purpose? To conceal or disguise, we mentioned, and the difference between concealing is make it invisible to others, disguising visible but appearing differently. To disguise or conceal is the criminal origin of this money. Okay. Here because it is not clear. Okay, criminal origin. Why is criminal origin? Because it's coming. This money is coming out of a crime. Okay. And I need to understand very clearly. There is a difference. Money laundering is a secondary offense. Secondary offense. It's not primary offense. Primary offense is the offense that I conducted at the first beginning. Then once I conduct this criminal offense, I get some money out of it, I start to launder the money, and this therefore is a secondary offense. But what are the primary offenses? If committed, whatever money come out of it will be considered as money laundering. Let's look at it. First, narcotics, any type of drugs dealing is criminal. And therefore, any money coming off distribution of drugs, we call it narcotics, psychotropic substances, sometimes it's medicine used as drugs. Yeah. Sometimes are really drugs. And sometimes, like we call it, some kind of medicine used as being drugs. That reason, some kind of medicine, you have to take something from doctor to be able to use it. And you have different type of drugs, synthetic drugs, original drugs, and so on. Whatever related to drugs, distribution, production of drugs, any money coming out of it is dirty money, and therefore whatever use of this money is a money laundering. Okay. Kidnapping, piracy, extortion, terrorism. all crimes committed against environment, like dumping and all these type of things, illicit dealing in firearms and ammunition. From where do you think all these terrorists are taking their arms or ammunition? They're taking from these dealers. Okay. Bribery, and we're going to speak a little bit today about bribery, embezzlement, corruption, tax evasion. Tax evasion is a crime by itself. Any money coming out of tax evasion is a money laundering, just to clarify this. Fraud, I'm going to speak a little bit about fraud, breach of trust, theft, smuggling, cyber crimes, human trafficking, all type of human trafficking, prostitution and so on, modern slavery, we heard some about it, illegal immigration, you hear of these people taking boats from Mediterranean and crossing to Europe. There are agents doing this. These agents are criminal and taking money, and whatever do this money is, we consider as money laundering, sex exploitation and so on, okay? These are what we call it the primary offenses. Once somebody conduct these primary offenses, any money coming out of it is any use, if just you put it in your pocket, this is money laundering, okay? And therefore, it comes as a secondary offense. If I have primary offense, make it clear, all what I mentioned before, then money coming out of it, it's criminal money, I start to use it, therefore I come to secondary offense, which is the money laundering, okay? Somebody, since I have been compliance for a long years, I will never tell you how many years, so that you don't guess anything. Since some people will come to me, why you are against money laundering? It's bringing money to us. This is very short-sighting, short-thinking. No, money laundering is not good. Why is this? Let's see what is not good. First, it affects integrity and reputation of the... Because money laundering is highly related to corruption. Do you remember in the definition of money laundering, assist what? Assisting. Money launderer need assistance to do the money laundering. And for this, they have to be bribes. Whenever in a country or in a society or an organization you have too much money laundering, by definition, you have too much corruption. This is an equation, equal. Money laundering equal corruption. You cannot say, I have money laundering, but I don't have corruption. It doesn't work like this. Because money launderer, they need to launder their money and need people to assist them. In order to assist them, they need to give them bribes and therefore get into corruption. From the other side, corrupted people need to launder their money. You agree with me? It's coming from two ways. Money laundering lead to corruption. On the other side, corruption lead to what? Money laundering. How it works together, okay? For whenever you have a society, too much money laundering, by definition, you have too much corruption, and therefore integrity and reputation of the market is down, whether it's a country or just an organization. Okay. Secondly, and this most importantly, effect on economy. Some people, that, as I said before, saying, okay, we're receiving money. It's okay, but this is called short money. They call it, it's dirty money. They call it hot money. It come quickly and goes quickly, okay? As you said here, inexplicable change in money and money demand and supply. Countries exchange money together. They receive money and they send money. This is controlled by the government. But if this money is not visible to the government, they cannot control it. Therefore, there is some money coming in and some money coming out. The government or the authorities don't control it. This is the effect of money laundering. Sometimes, for instance, if you find a stock exchange, pumping, we call it pumping, but somebody investing money into the exchange. Then after a time, they would do move. Happening is called dumping, pumping and dumping. What happened? The exchange gets up due to some extra money coming, hot money coming to it. And after 3-4 months, they said, enough this exchange, we go to another place, because money launderers, they move money all the time. They never keep money in any place. Took the money, all the stock exchange will go down. Pumping and dumping. We have seen this in some exchanges that rely on nothing about money laundering. That's the importance of training. Or he suspected. After suspected, he did what? Nothing. Again, a prosecution. He should have done what? reported. If you suspect, if you don't suspect because of negligence or because of a lack of knowledge, or if you suspected but you didn't report it, you can part of the conspiracy of money laundering. Okay, you are contributing in the money laundering scheme. Okay. Somebody assisting, it means that I know. In this case, I go to the bank, I pay a bribe to a clerk, to the teller, I tell him, this is dirty money, help me to launder this money, I'll give you some bribe or some money. He's assisting, he's legally, willingly assisting the money laundering, okay? And for what purpose? To conceal or disguise, we mentioned, and the difference between concealing is make it invisible to others, disguising visible but appearing differently. To disguise or conceal is the criminal origin of this money, okay? Because it's not clear. Okay, criminal origin. Why is criminal origin? Because it's coming, this money is coming out of a crime. Okay, and I need to understand very clearly, there is a difference. Money laundering is a secondary offense. Secondary offense. It's not primary offense. Primary offense is the offense that I conducted at the first beginning. Then once I conduct this criminal offense, I get some money out of it, I start to launder the money, and this, therefore, is a secondary offense. But what are the primary offenses? If committed, whatever money come out of it will be considered as money laundering. Let's look at it. First, narcotics, any type of drugs dealing is criminal. And therefore, any money coming off distribution of drugs, we call it narcotics, psychotropic substances, sometimes it's medicine used as drugs. Yeah. Sometimes are really drugs, and sometimes, like we call it, some kind of medicine used as being drugs. That reason, some kind of medicine, you have to take something from doctor to be able to use it. And you have different type of drugs, synthetic drugs, original drugs, and so on. Whatever related to drugs, distribution, production of drugs, any money coming out of it is dirty money, and therefore, whatever use of this money is a money laundering. Okay, kidnapping, piracy, extortion, terrorism. This will be, I think, available if you want. Unfortunately, the timing is. But I think we cover much of the, and I could say, 80% of the presentation. Okay, for now we can go so that I don't take much time of my next colleague, and not trespass on his timing. We have 10 minutes of any questions. Please go ahead. With Mike, please, because yes.
Thank you for the nice presentation and the knowledge on AML. I'm just trying to eliminate all the DIFC entities, Abu Dhabi Global Market and financial setups.
Yes.
If you eliminate all those, we being a professionals from auditor background or CSP background, just want to know what are the roles which as a corporate service provider or auditor we bear in our head, so that if we find any abnormality in a client side, how should we report to the central bank or whichever authority which comes into? And the second leading question is, as you are already part of the professional setup, how many such cases had you reported in last 1 year? I'm not talking from the financial perspective.
From a DMC perspective, you mean?
No, not from a DMC perspective.
Yeah.
From a professional standpoint of view, as you provide professional services, advisors,
yeah.
Anything you heard being reported by the professionals so far?
We are a contracting company.
Yes.
I put a disclaimer that it's a general question.
Yes.
Generally, recruitment agencies provide services for recruitment, and yes. We pay fees for yes. recruitment. But for labor from India or any other country or Pakistan or Nepal, in revert of appointing laborers, they are paying us. So is this will count in a money laundering?
No, as long as
they are taking yes. money from the native country, a big amount of money, and
yeah.
part of the
Hello. Yeah, 2 days back I happened to listen to the US Undersecretary of Treasury,
yes.
who is also heading the FATF as well as US AMLSCU in DIFC. And there a clear mandate or a clear dictum was given through the Trump administration that none of the companies should be dealing with Iran, and the window given was only 180 days.
Yeah.
And the dictum was very blunt and very straightforward that anyone who is going to deal with Iran, the consequences would be very severe.
Yes.
My question is, how serious is the implication in terms of anyone dealing with Iran? And secondly, because the entire oil supply from Iran will get affected.
Yes.
So how will be the effect on the oil prices? Although it's a commercial question, but people see that the price is going up from $70 yeah. to maybe around $100. So yeah. if you can throw light on both these points.
Sure.
Actually, I wanted to know in case of third port shipments, shipments moving from one destination to the other,
yes.
how do we ensure it's not a phantom shipping?
It's very important question.
Yeah, because it's a very pertinent issue in this part of the world, particularly. Yeah.
This is a very good question because...
Though the case that, the context that I am talking about is, you know, the proceeds are genuinely from the customers.
Yeah.
But then I want to ensure that the goods have actually moved or not.
Okay. Transshipment is one of way to do manipulation in trade finance. Do you remember? Makes sense from business perspective in this case, okay, and should be documented. And should you have to ask the question, they have to respond, you have to justify this response and to document all this. If doesn't make sense from business perspective, in this case, it will be a red flag. And if you're not satisfied with the reply, you should terminate the relationship. This is how we work with this. Okay.
Good morning, sir.
Yes.
Morning. Jitendra Bhatia. You referred to the responsibilities of professional service providers.
Yes.
Could you please throw some light on what are the obligations for CFOs and finance managers and what are their responsibilities and any practical case you've seen in this regard?
Yeah, very good question. Only in the middle, which is compliance. The three levels. Okay. The first level, the business itself. Second level, compliance risk management. Third level, we call it assurance with mainly the auditing to make sure that everyone is following this rule and is compliant. Okay. This respond to your question?
Thank you, everyone, for the questions. I'm sure you will have more questions, which we can take offline. The speaker will be with us for some time. May I request now our chairman and vice chairman to please come on the stage to felicitate our speaker, Mr. Hassan Nasser. A big round of applause for Mr. Hassan.
Next session is by CA Amarjit Chopra. CA Amarjit Chopra, with more than four decades of standing, was the president of the institute for the year 2010-2011. He was selected as the vice president of the ICAI for the year 2009-2010. Having a post-graduation from Delhi University in 1973, he qualified as a CA in 1975. He was elected to Northern India Regional Council of the Institute for the consecutive two terms, 1985-1988, and 1988 and 1991, and became his chairman in 1988-89. He was elected to the Central Council of the ICA for the first time for the term 1998-2001. During his tenure in the Central Council, he was the chairman of the Accounting Standard Board, Auditing and Assurance Standard Board, and Corporate Laws Committee for 2 years each, and has been chairman of the Expert Advisory Committee, Financial Reporting Review Board, Committee on Corporate Governance, and Committee on Internal Audit for 1 year each. He had also been the vice chairman of Electoral Reforms Committee, Ethical Standards Board, Accounting Standards Board, Professional Development Committee in various years. He represented the ICAI in the National Standards Setters meeting of IAASB in London and Brussels, as well as accounting standard issues before IASB and UK Accounting Standard Board at London. Please join me in welcoming CA Amarjit Chopra.
Managing committee members of Dubai chapter and ladies and gentlemen, I really need to thank the managing committee for providing this opportunity to be with you this morning. I think coming to Dubai is always a pleasure. Rather, traveling to this part of the world is always a pleasure. And I have been talking within the institute and outside the institute that probably we need at India to learn a lot for organizing the programs from our outside chapters. I think this speaks volumes for your abilities. In particular, I would like to thank Naveen ji and Namish ji and of course all other committee members. A very selfish interest in acknowledging it, because in one of the seminars when I was talking for about 45 minutes, one of the gentlemen was coming from behind with a stick in his hand, and I immediately got scared and stopped speaking. He said, no, no, you go ahead, you speak. I only want to find out who brought you here, basically. So I think if at all you have any observations, you can have it on them rather than on me. The topic which has been given to me, I think I don't belong to 21st century. I will be just going extempore. I don't have any slide presentation for you. I must say one thing, that the topic which has been given to me is corporate governance, the trends, implications. Coming from India, and I think most of us are, I think world over, India is not an exception to this today. There are serious concerns with regard to corporate governance everywhere. People may talk of it in context of one country, but I personally feel I have gone through various cases which have happened. And I think in your part of the world also there is some case which is going on, and a top company might be liquidated. And these are all governance issues at the end of the day. We all talk of governance. Somewhere or the other, we need to find out about the governance, but this is more of misgovernance rather than the governance all over in the corporate world. I'll be starting with some of the examples, some of the cases which one has gone through, and then come to the what can be recommendations, how it can be saved, what needs to be looked at. See, in one of the cases what happened was, and this is all connected with the governance levels. Of course, when we talk of governance, governance only means you lay down certain procedures, processes, make sure that by following those processes and procedures, holding the meetings of the board, committees, etc., you are able to reach a stage where else you can maximize the wealth of the stakeholders. I'm not talking of the shareholders. Let me be very clear about it. Because each one of us confuses the wealth maximization of the shareholders. I think this is the greatest myth. It has to be the maximization of the wealth for the stakeholders. Even government is a stakeholder, the creditors are the stakeholders, the bankers are the stakeholders, the shareholders are stakeholders, but to me, employees are the biggest stakeholders in the organization today. And if at all any organization goes down, it is the employees who suffer the most. We may or may not realize it in the longer run, but somewhere or the other, if you really ask me, the worst sufferer are the employees in that particular case. So whenever I talk of the maximization of the wealth of the stakeholders. I will never talk of the maximization of the wealth of the shareholder. In a recent case in our country, and I think you all know about the case, I'm not naming the case, that's all. Now, one of the chairmen has been sacked by the board. And the chairman has been sacked. Why the chairman has been sacked? The chairman has been sacked because of the fact that probably he didn't wish to carry on the agenda of the old management. Now, that management might have committed to any number of projects. Now, some of those projects could have been very good. Some of those projects would have been bleeding. However close it might be to the heart of the earlier chairman, I don't want to get into the details thereof, it could have been really a pet project of the earlier chairman.
But if that project is actually bleeding and is causing drain on the resources of the company, I don't think that can be continued under any circumstances. And if the new chairman really wants to come to the terms and can bring to the table that I wish to discontinue this particular project, and then the entire group is managed to throw this particular chairman out, then I think we are only trying to protect the interest of one shareholder, nothing more than that, if you really ask me, and damaging the institution. I think one of the biggest flaws of the governance levels in world over, probably in India it is a little bit more, because family comes into play immediately in any of the companies today. Some of the groups are identified by the names of the people rather than by the group itself. What happens in the bargain is that people who retire don't want to retire in grace. I think people have to learn to retire in grace somewhere or the other. Howsoever good you might have been, howsoever good you might have been to form, really to be the founder of a particular organization. It didn't happen in one company, it happened in another company also. Now there also the new CEO had been sacked basically, because one of the old shareholders, the majority shareholders, found whatever he wanted to continue is not being continued. I don't want to get into the details thereof, but I personally feel this is one of the major flaws in the governance levels, in India at least, that the people who retire must sit back, take a seat there. You have played your innings basically. I always think that as a past president of the institute, if at all I have a role to play is only to guide if somebody comes to me. Or if I find something is going wrong, I can just pick up the phone and talk to the president or vice president and say that, please look at it. Nothing more than that. I don't think I can meddle into the affairs of the institute today. I think similarly, any past chairman or past CEO or past MD of the organization, if tries to meddle into the affairs of the organization, then it's a misgovernance, to my mind. One must really take a back seat, retire, and retire gracefully from there. And then you have maximized your wealth in your own times, so let's be very happy with this. You earned a particular name. The other case that I wanted to start with was, and this you will find very interesting from the governance angle, basically, because my entire talk will be more of these kind of examples, because I personally feel you have to really relate yourself to a given situation and then find what kind of a governance and how do you really improve it. In one of the companies, there was a talk in US, because this company filed in SEC, before the SEC, that they bribed certain officials to procure the orders in a country, different country, not in US, outside. Now naturally, when it came to the other country, it was a matter of concern that if their officials have been bribed, there were hues and cries in the parliament, investigators were appointed, investigators went into the entire situation, and investigators found out very interesting scenarios there. One of the questions was asked in the morning, the responsibility of CFO, CEO, etc., in various matters. Now, in this particular company, what was happening, there was a cash in hand, always, which was about $1 million by that yardstick. Today, it could be a little bit lesser in terms of millions. And the company didn't require that kind of a cash in any case. And that cash continued to be shown as a part of cash. But the most interesting part was that outside that cash in hand, everywhere there was a note, in bracket, IOU, and that IOU continued to be outstanding. I think each one of us knows the meaning of IOU. We are all chartered accountants. I don't need to explain what IOU means. Now, if one went into the internal auditor's reports, internal auditor, why I say I'm now bringing various players into play, because governance, any kind of governance in corporate, brings into focus the promoters, the shareholders, the regulators, the board of directors, and the auditors also. Let me be very clear, whether they are statutory auditors or they are the internal auditors. One of the key players is auditor also, and it can be internal and it can be statutory. Now, this internal auditor, every quarter will write one beautiful sentence in his internal audit report, and he will say, large amount of IOUs have been outstanding for a long period of time. Very nice statement to be made, no doubt about it. Nothing more than this he will write. So when the investigation was going on, he was put on oath, and he was asked the question, what does it mean? In Hindi, he replied, sir, kai large amount ki IOUs kafi der se khadi hain. To humne kaha, itna to humko bhi pata yaar. Translation, we know how to do it in Hindi. Don't worry about it. What we want to know from you is, what is the amount of the IOU? And what is the period of IOU being outstanding? Because an IOU, if at all is there, it should be adjusted within a period of 2 days, 3 days, maximum 7 days, nothing beyond that. He said, sir, this is perpetual. Always this kind of a situation is there. Maybe $1 million, maybe slightly less than $1 million, it was always outstanding. He said, but you never wrote it. And the audit committee kept on perusing the internal audit reports, but never acted on that. But when the internal, when this investigator went little deep into the matter, there were various branches of this particular company all over the country. There were cash books, on the top of which there was a slip, affixed, on which it was written, cash in hand so much, IOU so much, in bracket UTT, UTT. When people were examined on oath and were asked the question, what this word UTT means, they said, under the table transaction. Now, if this is being reflected on the face of the cash book, there are internal auditors, there are statutory auditors, irrespective of the size of the firm. I am not trying to get into the sizes of the firm. But the fact of the matter is that if it is written UTT, and someone has to get into, the matter, why UTT, for what UTT, and how this amount is being generated? And when this investigator went into the details further, because the role of audit committee will be very important when I discuss little later, when they went into this particular role later, they found out it was a continuous process of generating the cash in hand. Previous speaker was talking of generating of the cash, payment in cash. Now, by check every time for certain assignments, the money will go. And after having a cut of 6%, the money will come back. Someone were labor contractors, someone were other service providers, and the service providers where no service was ever provided for, no report on that service provision at all, basically, if you looked into the various records. Labor contractors at the places where no loading or unloading was to be done ever, basically. I think that is not something that the auditor cannot correlate. That is not something that the audit committee cannot find out under any circumstances. And that is not something that the CFO is not aware that it is not happening. And if it still happens, it speaks volumes of the misgovernance, if you ask me. And once the investigator submitted the report, this very company went to the settlement commission and surrendered only $23 million worth of expenses as unvouched and paid a tax of about $15 million thereon. Now, if this is not something which is to be looked into, what else is to be looked into by the audit committees? I'm coming to the biggest case, because now that is public, I can speak about it. Satyam. We all talk of governance, but sometimes what happens is that the image of the individuals becomes much larger, larger than the life size basically. And that creates a problem. And that was exactly what was happening in the Satyam. Raju's image had been taken to a level where nobody could have questioned him, nor the auditor, nor the directors, nor anybody else. But the audit committee chairman, who happened to be the dean of ISB, International School for Business Studies, you cannot have a more financial literate than audit committee chairman than the dean of the ISB for that particular matter. Because we all talk of the qualifications of the various directors, the audit committee chairman, et cetera, that he has to be financially literate. There could not be a more financially literate person. Now, in this company, I personally feel no auditor was required. Nobody was required to trace it, except the audit committee chairman. Every year, the money lying in the current account of the company was going up. And going up by that particular yardstick, basically at that time, it was more than $350 million in the current account. It started with about 250, 300, 350, 400 million dollars. Now, any audit committee chairman, a simple audit committee chairman who is financially illiterate as I am, if I am on the audit committee of any company today, I would have asked only one question. You tell me, if you have got about $400 million of the money and you have put it in the current account, and even if the interest rate is only 10%, at that particular time it was a high interest regime, basically, if the deposit rate is only 10%, it means every year you are losing about $40 million of interest. How you can do that? And on a continuous basis, you are trying to lose that particular interest. What kind of a CFO or what kind of a CEO you are? There was no rocket science involved to find out that there's something wrong, there's something fishy. And that is what it turned out to be. That there was no cash in hand, there was no current account balance at all. Whatever certificates Mr. Raju was giving to the auditors, those were all fudged. And the other problem was whether these auditors were receiving the confirmations from the banks directly or only Raju was giving it on the day of the board meeting. I think a good governance would require, I think SF-505 would definitely require that it is the auditor who has to receive it directly from the banker, the confirmation. It is not Mr. Raju who is to give you the confirmation, taking out of his table that please take it. I think that is where the governance failed so far as Satyam is concerned. The sales fudging, etc., I don't want to get into the details thereof for the time being. Today, in India, and I think the scenario is not better anywhere else, because whenever people talk of that in India this is the position, I always say the companies failed everywhere. In 2008, the banks failed world over except in India, and that's a testimony to the strong banking system in India for that matter. I always praise the Indian banking system irrespective of whatever is happening today. The banks failed in Germany, the banks failed in Japan, the banks failed in England, the banks failed in US, everywhere the banks failed except in India. And thanks to Mr. Y.V. Reddy at that particular point of time, who saved the Indian banking system. But then today the banking scenario has changed. But the companies failed all over, whether it was India or anywhere else. It was not Satyam only in India, not GTB only in India. Lehman Brothers failed. My friend talked of risk management. In one of the companies where I'm the chairman of the audit committee, one of the top companies came for the presentation of risk management. I have nothing against the top companies. I have nothing against the risk management. But I personally find, if you really ask me the question, a Lala in Chandni Chowk manages risk better than the top companies for that matter. I can tell you that. The reason being, he's connected. There is a pain in his heart when he loses money out of it. But a person who is managing the money of the public, he doesn't have that pain. That's the problem. I only asked him one question, whether the Lehman Brothers had this risk management system or not. He said, yes, sir, it was having. I said, 3 months before, you could not even assess, you could not identify that there is a risk to you. What to talk of the risk management systems? So the governance involves this. I will come back to it, because there are certain very important committees, out of which one is the risk management committee for that matter. But what one is trying to tell you is that there are issues after issues for that matter. But each player in the corporate governance, as I said, failed it. The promoters failed it. The shareholders failed it. Even the normal shareholder failed the corporate governance. The directors failed it altogether, basically, because the directors have become used to a particular lifestyle. They will come to the meeting without reading the agenda. Believe me, I have gone through now various boards. People come without reading even a page of an agenda, and then they start looking at the other, who is speaking, and then they will say, yes, yes, very nicely made out point. And I also wanted to say the same thing. And then their hand will extend for a cashew nut and then put it into the mouth, and that's the end of it, basically. The biggest culprit, if you ask me, is the board in the entire governance level's failure. Why I say so? And there are reasons for it, basically. Because these are the trends. This is where we have actually gone wrong. Everywhere we talk of independent directors. Somewhere it could be 50%, somewhere it could be 2/3 of the percentage of the total board of directors, somewhere it could be 40%, depending upon the company, depending upon the laws, depending upon the regulators. Succession planning. In India, succession planning is not much of a problem wherever there are family groups, because son in any case will take over from the father. But is that the succession planning? But there are enough number of companies where there is no succession planning. There is not even a talk of succession planning, believe me. Even in one of the companies where I sit on the board, this is one point that I've been raising. Because MD doesn't have a son, he only has 2 daughters. The daughters are living abroad, they don't want to come to India. There's no one else, and you are not willing to nominate someone else to be your successor. After all, the company has to go on. Some motivation has to be created, some incentive has to be given from somebody to say that you are going to take it over from me. Even a Guruji tries to nominate somebody so that he keeps on coming up. Like Baba Ramdev might have been saying that Mr. Balakrishnan is his successor, maybe in the periods to come, nobody knows. But what I am trying to say is that you have to have somebody nominated. You have to have at least identified somebody so that you can groom him, that he is going to succeed you. If you don't have that planning, I think this is one of the worst kind of governances that you have. And I personally find that there are a lot many things in which it doesn't happen. And in any company where most of your accounting decisions or most of other decisions are based upon the legal opinions alone, that company is in for a problem. You can be sure about it. I still remember 2009. In the first 6 months, the rupee went up like anything. And every top group in the company, in the country, booked huge gains because AS 11 permitted that. In the next 6 months, the rupee went down very badly. Nobody wanted to book a loss. And each one of the companies, whether it was Reliance, this was Mahindra, this was Tata's, the people whom one revers basically, they all went to the legal opinion and took a legal opinion from the lawyers. For the first time, I saw that accounting was being governed by the legal opinion. And they gave the opinion that accounting standards are under the rules. Schedule 6 is under the Act. At that time, it used to be Schedule 6. And Schedule 6 says very clearly, add or deduct the exchange losses or the gains. So you have to be guided by the Act. And NACAS also approved it at that particular point of time. And the legal opinion determined what the accounting treatment was to be. Wherever for determining any liability, whether it will not arise, you go immediately to the legal opinion. I think we are in for a troubled time. The board has to act as a board. The board has to exercise its own judgment. We have been failed by valuers, we have been failed by lawyers, we have been failed by auditors, we have been failed by the directors, we have been failed by virtually everybody. But then there are certain houses who have done wonderfully well also. I don't want to say only the negative side of it. But yes, we need to really rein in a lot many people, friends. There's no doubt in my mind. But as I said earlier, that I'm a born optimist. And one thing that I have to, lastly, the thing that I have to say is the directors on the board, particularly the audit committee on the board, must know what the accounting standards are, what the IT is. Naveen raised that particular issue. Believe me, if the directors themselves are not knowing what kind of software is being used, what are the implications thereof, whether the SAP has been implemented, not implemented, what kind of issues can be there in the SAP implementation or the GST implementation, what kind of audit committee governance we can give. Unfortunately, the training takes a back seat. Nobody wants to train the directors, basically. And I think that's, again, one of the issues in the governance. Friends, I think this is something which is very close to my heart. I can go on. Mr. Dalal has already come in. Of course, his session is after lunch. But believe him, he's one fellow whom I revere, basically. There's no doubt in my mind. He has been doing a fabulous job in the forensic audit. And sir, your job is going to increase. You can be sure. The way the banks have conducted themselves of late, you are in for the best of the times, basically. You can be sure about it. So to that extent, their misgovernance becomes good governance for you. So thanks a lot, friends, for a very, very patient hearing. And I shall be willing to reply any of your questions. It will be my privilege to answer any of your questions, because I definitely want some of the unpleasant also, or some of the pleasant also. And some of the issues I have personally thrown at you, if you can really raise those issues and you can give your own opinion also, particularly with regard to compensation to the independent directors. Yes, Bachchan.
Hello, sir.
I will answer that out.
So, okay. Sir, it's now become mandatory as per the Companies Act 2013. And my question is, with regard to corporate social responsibility, we as auditors or as part of the top financial management of a particular company, how would we ensure that the initiatives and the activities that is aligned for corporate social responsibility is put aside for the correct purposes that is mandated by the law?
Number so one, as I said, my sincere thanks.
We feel that you have an immense knowledge on the corporate governance side. Keeping in view the examples which you have given to us, your first example itself was very interesting, where the chairman couldn't save himself, actually.
Chairman couldn't save?
Himself. He was kicked out of one of the big groups of India. So if a chairman cannot save himself, how an auditor can save himself, or any independent director or an employee can save himself by highlighting a corporate governance issue? Second point is basically you mentioned 4 CA in a board, or one barber case which you have mentioned.
Yeah.
As you, I believe you have been a president of ICAI before, why ICAI being a statutory body, why ICAI cannot define the minimum qualification required for each member to be on the board? Why we cannot define, being for listed companies or go to the SEBI basically, all these reports which have been submitted, when we talk about Satyam, when we talk about any company, this happened, 400 millions were there on the current account. This has been submitted to the board, I believe. Am I right?
Yeah.
Or this has been submitted to the SEBI also.
Yeah.
Why there was nobody at the SEBI, or why there was nobody at ICAI looking at that?
If you can.
I would request our chairman, CA Naveen Sharma, vice chairman, CA Mahmood Bangara, and CA Babu Ibrahim to please come on the stage to felicitate CA Amarjeet Chopra. A big round of applause for Chopra sir.
See, I can only share with you that me and Babu share a particular relationship because the year I was the president, he was the chairman of the Southern India Regional Council, basically, for that matter. So to me, he will always remain the chairman, basically. And he always calls me my president, I don't know. But it has been a very, very pleasant relationship with him. I am telling him, why only to export the services? You export the CAs also, yeah. Don't worry about it. So that we have some lesser pressure in India and probably people can be settled more abroad. And I'm sure that under his leadership, this will happen. Thank you very much.
Honorable past president of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. I always call him as my president. And I have no doubt in saying that Chopraji is still being considered as one of the best presidents in the last 70 years of history of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. And you can imagine his youthfulness at the age of 66. Even today, he is one of the most sought-after speakers across the globe. And it is very difficult to get him as a speaker unless you block his date at least 3 months back. And his era as a president is still being remembered for taking the institute to newer heights. And I am very glad I've been also part of that success story as the chairman of the Southern region when my president was there at the center. Chairman of the Dubai chapter, very, very dynamic, one of the very eventful year we are having at this chapter this year, C.A. Naveen Sharma, my good friend and vice chairman, C.A. Mohammed Bangara, young and energetic secretary of the chapter, C.A. Anish, other office bearers, the eminent speaker, C.A. Chetan Dalal, who is considered to be one of the top-notch forensic auditor. And very, my dear colleagues, I'm extremely happy and delighted to stand before you as a chairman of the Committee for Export of CA Services and WTO. And I'm also proud to be part of this technical session on forensic crimes, corporate governance and forensic audit, and also to get the reflected glory of this grand program. I bring greetings from the President of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, C.A. Naveen N.D. Gupta, who has always considered this chapter as one of the best chapters across the globe. He has very specifically asked me to convey his greetings. And now you would all agree with me that Indian CA is in global demand and has gained greater acceptability as an accountancy professional. When we celebrate the Platinum Jubilee year, on behalf of the ICAI, let me take this opportunity to congratulate you for becoming the global brand ambassadors of the accountancy profession. In line with the vision of the Prime Minister, Honorable Modi ji, who has identified accounting and finance sector as one of the 12 champion sectors for export of services. This year, ICAI entrusted me with the mission to enhance and expand our global image and presence. There are several corporates and professional firms seeking services of Indian CAs for improving the global service quality, governance levels, and for adhering to the global financial reporting requirements. I have no doubt in saying that Indian CAs are the best suited to bridge this gap. I will take you to a short presentation on our new initiative, on the first overseas campus placement. Before that, let me salute you all for leaving the safe harbors and the comforts of the homeland in search of newer horizons and to become a global professional. The initiatives of our committee is strongly founded on the reputation all of you have laid globally for the brand Indian CA. Let me heartily congratulate all of you for bringing this Indian CA brand as a global brand. Now, let me quickly take you through the presentation. I am sure the future for Indian Chartered Accountants are quite promising. And when there is, global slowdown, the one set of professionals who is always in demand is finance professionals. See, when there are issues, it is only because of the management of the finance. Therefore, probably this is the best time to have our presence felt and contributions. Yeah, these are some of the initiatives of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India to align with the Honorable Prime Minister's vision to have finance and accountancy sector as a champion sector. One is overseas campus placement, which I'll touch upon you in detail. What are the initiatives which we are being taken? Member-to-member international network. In fact, our committee has cleared the networking guidelines and now it is before the council. Once it is approved by the council, what is being proposed is any member of the placed in Dubai can have a network arrangement or network partner in India, and you can officially share the fees. That is going to be the biggest advantage. This network will be officially recognized by the ICAI, and what is being proposed is member-to-member network, not with firm-to-firm. Initially, to start with, it will be a member-to-member arrangement. Then, short-term courses to meet the local demands. For example, the Institute has launched several certification courses, including on the VAT, which has been very popular in this part of the country. Addressing technological advancements, there are, even now, we have also formed a new digital accounting board, and we have been doing courses on blockchain and artificial intelligence. Foreign language courses, which we have, this is considered to be one of the major impediments for our members to going abroad, especially in the European countries. We already started with the Spanish, and I'm very glad to tell you that the moment we announced, the 30 seats have been sold out in no time, and the second batch is going. Therefore, we have been talking with other embassies. We'll be coming out with short-term courses, language learning courses on all the important languages in the European Union. Pilot incubation centers to be set up. This project is also being, we are planning to set up at least 12 incubation centers across the country to promote the startup initiatives. Global e-kits, this has already been there. If you want to travel to Ireland, there is a Ireland-specific kit which you can download from the ICA website and see what are the visa requirements, what are the job opportunities over there. Then MRAs and MOUs. This is a first-time initiative which I'm sure that every large corporate will be requiring chartered accountants. And every CFO of the large corporate is an Indian chartered accountant. Therefore, my earnest request, this is a maiden initiative. We bank upon your support. We are going to have an HR meet on 16th in Dubai for a luncheon session. And on the evening on 16th, we'll have one in Abu Dhabi. Therefore, kindly send your HR head. And Prabhadeep will be coordinating for that. Therefore, I really bank upon on your support for this initiative. Yeah, candidates. See, any candidate who is intending to be part of this, we have already nearly 4,000. I'm glad to say that already 4,000 chartered accountants have already registered on our portal for this. Shortlisting the companies.
between August 13th and August 18th, consent sending by the candidates, August 19th to August 20th, and dates of interviews, 24 to 26 at three locations, one in Chennai, one in Mumbai, one in New Delhi. Rest of the centers will be covered through video conferencing. Therefore, those who don't want to travel, they can go to the respective centers and get connected to the video. Yeah, this I have. Bangalore, Hyderabad, Jaipur, Calcutta, and remaining centers will be on video. Guidelines for the candidates. They have to upload. This is the beauty of this campus placement is unlike, we have a local campus placement which is only for the new freshly qualified chartered accountants. This campus is for varied levels of experience. Therefore, anyone who is interested, even those who are working in this part of the region, if you want to have a change in employment, please register in this portal so that you get a wider opportunity. Upload their CV. Then candidates can carry the originals at the time of interview, can opt for only one center. See, you have to decide which is the center you will be appearing. Therefore, once you opt for the center, we will not allow you to change the center because the company, those who want to interview you, will be only visiting that center. Okay, once registered and shortlisted, it is mandatory to attend the interview. Elsewhere, will be debarred from future attempts because this is one practical problem we are facing. Many register, then they don't appear for the interview. No restriction on the number of interviews a candidate can attend at the selected center. You can attend for any number of companies, provided they shortlist you. First, they have to shortlist you. Schedule of activities. Yeah, this is a schedule. 1st June, we have already started that, opened up the portal for candidate registration. Last date is 31st of July. Start date for registration of participating organization, it is already started on 1st July. And the last date is 31st of July. And 1st August, opening of database for participating organization. See, once the organization register, the entire CVs of the candidates will be available to the organization for first shortlisting of the candidates. And 1st to 18th, shortlisting by participating organizations, and 19th to 28th, consent to be given by candidates for organizations opted by them. Once the candidates select them, then you have to give their consent to appear for the interview. And 22nd is the written test. Some other companies may be requiring written tests that will be facilitated on 22nd. Yeah. Therefore, my request to all of you is I'll be grateful, and the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India will be grateful to have this project to be made successful. And I'm sure if all of you encourage your own organizations to participate in this, this will be a great event. We target at least 100 companies to be coming for this event. And we expect around 10,000 chartered accountants to be getting registered for this. Therefore, thank you once again. I thank the office bearers of the Dubai chapter for this opportunity. Thank you.